Welcome to the Jennings Road Church of Christ. As always, we're glad that you've chosen to worship with us. Don't forget, at the end of today's sermon, we will be doing communion together if you so choose. Use whatever you have on hand. I, this morning, will do an animal cracker and Gatorade. I like Gatorade. So, this morning's sermon is titled Not Far, from the book of Mark, chapter 12, verses 32 through 34. I am almost done with doing these dumb topical sermons. When pastors do topical sermons, it is easy to run out of ideas. What do I preach on? What do I preach on? What do I preach on? And it's too easy to be swayed by, well, I think this is important, so I'm going to preach on it. That said, I think these things are important, so I'm going to preach on them, right? Now, next week, speaking of things that I'd love to preach on, next week we get back to the Sermon on the Mount, and I'm preaching on lust, adultery, and divorce. The holy trifecta. So, now I will tell you this. Next week, one of the key things that I will be talking about, look, you can skip next week's sermon, is a lot of times when it comes to divorce, especially if we're going through it or we're considering it, we tend to seek out support. Support. So we read articles that support how we feel. We tend to spend more time with friends that support us in our feelings and our decisions versus finding a solution. Maybe talking with people that hold us to God's word and to God's standard. And that's a lot of times what happens with topical sermons. And that's why I much more prefer expository, because I don't want to preach about lust, divorce, and adultery. But it's in the Sermon on the Mount, and I cannot skip it without looking like a dope. All right? And I'm afraid during this pandemic, too many of us as believers, we tend to look for support. Those that support us, our ideals, what we think is right, versus what does God want? And so we've been talking about some things that are foundational to Jennings Road. 2 weeks ago, we talked about how we are called to be united spiritually. Jesus, in his final prayer in John chapter 17. Everything right now tends to divide us, okay? So if we say something politically, immediately those that oppose that jump right on. And we've got to be careful about those kinds of things. And I've been reading more and more stuff about when did caring for the least of these become political, right? And so speaking of least of these, the least of these has been a very motivating factor in the reason that we're not back in the church building yet with this pandemic going on. And I'm hearing some good things about the possibility of a vaccine. And again, we turn that into what we want. I'm hearing way too many people, even at the beginning of this, is, well, if you're at risk, stay home. How is that caring for the least of these? I don't understand that. Honestly, I really, really don't. And part of the problem is I'm now one of the least of these. I'm horribly at risk, not just for coronavirus, but all kinds of things with my recent hospitalization. And when somebody tells me, well, the death rate is really low, every single statistic of a person that has died has a name, has a history, has a family that is absolutely crushed. I care for the least of these, and I don't want to put the least of these at risk at Jennings Road just because we think being in a building is important. And there's much value to be in a building, but not at the risk of one life. Today's text should be no-brainer, and yet I'm starting to see these verses, loving God and loving your neighbor as yourself, being used to support selfishness. And I don't understand that. I don't get it. These verses, as we talked about last week, Christianity is about serving others. And now I'm starting to see on social media especially, people using these verses to support their personal freedom and their personal opinion. No. You've heard those verses for two decades now at Jennings Road. Love God and love your neighbor as yourself. But one of the things that I have not done is told you what comes after that. And that's what we're going to talk about today in the book of Mark as we open our Bibles. We are excited when we open God's word. So open your Bibles to the book of Mark. Book of Mark is about two-thirds of the way back through your Bible. Mark chapter 12. And Jesus is having a conversation with the church leaders of the day. They're trying to trap him and use word problems. Ooh, word problems. Get out of here. Not falling for it. And then one of the church leaders has just been sitting and listening. And then he says to Jesus, hey, What's most important? Out of all the Old Testament laws, what's most important? And Jesus says, love God, love your neighbor as yourself. And then I want to pick up the story in verse 32. What happens after those very famous verses? Listen to this church leader in verse 32. Because one of the things that we always have to remember about loving God and loving your neighbor as yourself is that God commanded it. It's all about God, right? All about God, not my personal opinion. Verse 32, Mark chapter 12. Well said, teacher, the man replied, you are right in saying that God is one and there is no other but him. Everything that we as Christian believers say, everything that we as Christian believers do, everything that we as Christian believers think should all be unified with God. God should be at the center of everything we say, do, and think. The danger is, and this is what I'm beginning to see develop now in our Christian culture, our church culture, we are making an idol out of personal preference. Now, we've always done that. The pandemic didn't necessarily expose that attitude because we've always made personal preference a thing. Hymns versus contemporary Christian songs. No instruments, instruments. There's so many things that we can just go down the list of. And dumb pastors are the worst about this. I already told you. That's why some pastors preach topical sermons, because it's the topics that they like, they know will get an amen, and they just jump into it. We have made a personal idol out of being Americans. And that has infiltrated the church. Does your life reflect that God and God alone drives you? That's what's motivating you. That's what you're passionate about. People knowing God and you sharing, hey, this is what God thinks. This is what he says. That's what I'm going to do. Is God your motivating factor for everything that you're going to do today? In your relationships, in your thoughts, in what you're going to watch, in what you're going to post, in what you're going to read? Are you doing everything for his glory or your personal satisfaction? Whew. I don't like that one because I know which side I tend to be on. Let's allow God to be our driving, motivating factor. Love God. But we got to go beyond. We have to go beyond just simply that. Verse 33. To love him, remember, this is one of the teachers of the law talking with Jesus, responding to the whole love God, love your neighbor as yourself. To love him with all your heart, with all your understanding, and with all your strength, and to love your neighbor as yourself, listen to these words. Underline them, highlight them. I tell you to tear them out of your Bible and post them to your forehead, but then you wouldn't be able to read them. To love God, love your neighbor as yourself, is more important than all the burnt offerings and sacrifices. Whoa! Now, listen to what this teacher of the law is saying. Because the way they worshiped back then in Old Testament times was with burnt offerings and sacrifices. And this guy gets it. It's not about the ritual. Not sure I said that word right. Ritual. Hey, nailed it. It's not about the ritual. I did it again. It's not about the ritual. It's about the relationship that we have with God and others. Come on. Who doesn't want to be back in the building? You know how limited I am with ministry opportunities and that's how we've created the Christianity culture in America to best reach people, is by being in a building. Don't need that building. Just love God. Love your neighbor. Those things are important, but not at the expense of loving God and loving our neighbor. And so, guys, seriously, I am reading constantly everything I can about the virus and how it affects the church. And regardless of what you believe about it, there are people dying. There are people at risk. And right now, there's no solution to that. And so when I think about loving God and loving my neighbor, I'm like, you know what? I'd rather be in the building. I don't like masks. It's hard as a heart patient when it's humid outside to wear a mask because it's hard to breathe anyway. I'm wearing it. I'm wearing it. It is time to admit that things we think are honoring God above all else aren't all that important. It's just not important. And they're certainly not as important as loving God and loving others. Far too often lately, we as a church, and I'm speaking generally now, we're being driven by fear and anxiety, and our social media posts are reflecting it. It's time to go beyond what we think church should be and look to see what God said is most important, loving God and loving others. Maybe we should spend time this week and maybe today answering this question. What do we think is most important? And is that really showing that we love God and love our neighbors? All right, finally, you know what that means? Comes another half hour. Finally, we have a goal that we should be focused on with everything that's driving us right now, with loving God and loving our neighbor. Verse 34, Jesus finally responds. When Jesus saw that he had answered wisely, he said to him, listen to this. When we get a hold of the concept that loving God and loving our neighbor is not as important as the things that we think are important to God, you are not far, it's the title of the sermon, you are not far from the kingdom of God. And from then on, I like this part, and from then on, no one dared ask him any more questions. To be near to the kingdom of God is to understand that loving God and others is more important than what we think is important to God. Now, I want you to see at the end of that too, no one else dared ask him questions. This entire chapter, and I encourage you to read it, of Mark chapter 12, is the church leaders trying to trap Jesus. And he began with a parable about how church leaders had taken worship, taken church, and turned it into something that God did not want. It was not honoring to him. Woo! That's big time for somebody like me that's been leading the church now for 25 years. Oh. They got into a debate about the Roman government because it wasn't godly. And so some people were arguing whether they should pay taxes or not. You might not like the answer to that if you don't think we have to obey the government at all. But it doesn't matter what you or I think about the government. Jesus said, pay your taxes. And then he had a conversation about people that were just simply stuck in the past. God did this, God did that, that's who God is. And Jesus says, no, God's alive and well now. And if you're stuck in the past of how you think God acts or what he does or what he thinks is important. You're missing God now. Oh, this entire chapter preaches. And then he comes up with love God and love your neighbor as yourself. That's powerful stuff, man. And at Jennings Road, we love God and we love our neighbors, and we are willing to be selfless for others. But that's just simply who we are. And that may not work for you. Okay. Too bad. The problem becomes when we hear this, love your neighbor as yourself. Yeah, but what about, and when that happens, my brain just goes, and it's not a big because not a big brain. Stop. Love your neighbor as yourself. Yeah, but what about, and then it's always something that you or I think is very, very important. And Jesus literally says, love your neighbor as yourself. And far too many of us love our neighbor as ourself, personal opinions, personal motivations, what we think is right, what we think is important. And that is not the standard that God used. Love God, love your neighbor. Loving your neighbor is about serving one another, is about telling people that have been forgotten, we hear you, we see you, we love you, we want you to know the God that loves us. I am very thankful that when Jesus died on the cross, or when he was on his way to the cross, he didn't say, well, you know, God so loved the world that he gave his only son, but he didn't. That's good news for you.
Sweet honey on my lips.
recognize his sacrifice this morning. Jesus took that bread and he broke it. And he told us to do this in remembrance of him and the sacrifice that he made. So let's do communion this morning, his broken body. And in the same way, he took the cup. And he said, this represents my blood that is shed for our sins. So let's remember that as we do this in remembrance of him. Will you pray with me? Father, we love you and we thank you for your word. This teacher, I was fascinated by the words that he said. This is not what I was going to preach on this morning. I was just simply going to do the love God, love your neighbor thing. This was so convicting, God. I pray that we as a church, that we as a body of believers would be motivated by you right now, this morning, today. Man, it's so easy to be selfish. I just want to be selfish. It's human nature. I know. I get it. I struggle with it. Help us to be a people of repentance, of forgiveness, of mercy, and motivated to bring you glory. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Hey, everybody, thank you so much for joining me today. And I hope that you have found value in us providing this for you online. Join me next week, next Sunday, right back here on YouTube and Facebook as we jump right back into the Sermon on the Mount. And you already heard what I'm talking about. So here we go. All right, guys, I will see you next Sunday, if not before. Thanks, everybody.